We'll continue the next part of the urinary system, that is development of urinary bladder. I hope all must have joined. So today's objectives are, we start with the cloaca in short and how it is divided, then we'll form, I think, okay, whether I'm audible. Yes, can you hear me? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, the development of urinary bladder, the objectives are, we'll continue with the cloaca and its division. Something about vesico-urethral canal, how it is formed, the steps of development of urinary bladder. The trigone of the bladder, it develops separately, so we'll discuss it. Then allantois and its fate, congenital anomalies of urinary bladder as well as urethra. Okay? So, the features of urinary bladder, you know it is having three layers. The innermost layer, which is mucosa, it is lined by transitional epithelium, right? The middle layer, which is the smooth muscle layer and connective tissue layer. While outer layer is serous layer. So these are the three layers, you know the gross features of urinary bladder. In the interior, the triangular area is there towards the base and it is called as trigone of bladder. The ureter opens at the superolateral angle of trigone, while apex is opening towards the caudal end or the apex of triangle, the urethral orifice is present. So three openings are related with trigone, ureters at superolateral angle and urethral opening is at apex. So this is the general features. So we see all these structures, how they developed and what are the different sources from which it develops. So urinary bladder, basically it is derived from urogenital sinus, as I mentioned in first lecture. It's ventral part of the cloaca. So ventral part of cloaca, which is forming primitive urogenital sinus, it gave rise to the urinary bladder. So this is cloaca. And this we have already discussed the cloaca, which is a hindgut part. And it is separated by a developing urorectal septum, which grows downwards towards the cloacal membrane, right? So this urorectal septum, it divides this cloaca into two parts, the ventral part and the dorsal part, right? The ventral part is called as primitive urogenital sinus, while dorsal part is called as primitive rectum. So this cloaca is contributing the two system, the urinary system as well as digestive system. When this grows towards the cloacal membrane, the lower end, the apex of this urorectal septum, it forms the perineum wall. Okay. So we are concentrating on the urogenital sinus, which ultimately gives rise to urinary bladder. So this cloaca contributes two system, urinary and digestive system. This urorectal septum, which divides into two parts, it developed around 4 to 7 weeks of intrauterine life. So it divides this cloaca into the ventral primitive urogenital sinus and dorsal primitive rectum. This developing urorectal septum, which grows downwards, reaches the cloacal membrane and its tip, which is to at the level of cloacal membrane, contributes perineal wall. And because of this septum, the cloacal membrane is also divided into two parts. The ventral part or anterior part is urogenital membrane and posterior part is the anal membrane. I hope all must have joined. Still the students are joining. So this is introduction about the cloaca, right? So this cloaca, which is divided by the uroreceptum into the two parts. The ventral part is primitive urogenital sinus and dorsal part is primitive rectum. The lower end of the uroreceptum contributes perineal body, and cloacal membrane divides into two parts, the ventral urogenital membrane while the dorsal anal. Okay, so now what about, what is the fate of this primitive urogenital sinus? It is further divided by the opening of mesonephric duct into two parts, the cranial and the caudal part, right? The cranial part is called as vesico-urethral canal. By the caudal part, it is forming the definitive urogenital sinus, right? So because of the opening of mesonephric duct, this primitive urogenital sinus is divided into the two parts, the cranial vesico-urethral canal and caudal, the definitive urogenital sinus. This vesico-urethral canal, it has got the upper dilated part and lower the narrow part. The upper dilated part of this vesico-urethral canal, it forms the urinary bladder. While lower, this is yellow color, lower narrow part, it contributes primitive urethra, right? So the vesico-urethral canal contributes the urinary bladder by the upper expanded part and primitive urethra, that is the proximal most part of the urethra, which is mainly the proximal part of the prostatic urethra in males. What happens to this definitive urogenital sinus? It is further divides into two parts, okay? The cranial part is the pelvic part of urogenital sinus and caudal part is the phallic part of urogenital sinus. I think students are joining. All must have joined. Still students are joining. You will miss. It's already 10:15, so you should have joined till now. The urinary bladder is derived from upper dilated part of the vesico-urethral canal. So the same thing here, the what happens to this primitive urogenital sinus by the opening of mesonephric duct, it divides into the two parts, the cranial vesico-urethral canal and caudal definitive urogenital sinus. This definitive urogenital sinus is further divided into the cranial pelvic part and caudal phallic part. And this is a flow chart which is showing the fate of cloaca, which is divides into the two parts, the primitive rectum and primitive urogenital sinus, which further divides into two parts, the definitive urogenital sinus and cranial vesico-urethral canal, which give rise to the urinary bladder and primitive urethra, which is corresponding with the prostatic urethra in male, while the definitive urogenitis sinus will give rise to pelvic part and phallic part, which contributes the remaining part of the urethra. Okay, that is the membranous part, part of the prostatic urethra, membranous urethra, and penile. So, what happens to this vesico-urethral canal once it is formed? So it has got the upper wider part and lower narrow part, right? The allantois, of course, it is present at the apex of upper wider part. This is the tubule-like structure which is connected to the umbilicus from the apex of urinary bladder. So, what are the sources of development of urinary bladder? It is derived from two sources. First is dilated part of vesico-urethral canal, and second is the proximal part of allantois. the very small part, proximal part of allantois, it contributes the apex of urinary bladder. And what happens to the lower part of this vesicoureteral canal, narrow part, it contributes primitive urethra, right? So the sources of urinary bladder is mainly the upper dilated part of vesicoureteral canal, and second is the small part, that is the proximal part of allantois, contributes apex of bladder. Okay, so this is explaining everything. So this is the primitive urogenital sinus, this is developing urorectal septum, this is vesicoureteral canal, allantois, this is the mesonephric duct which opens, which gives rise to the two parts. This is definitive urogenital sinus, divides into pelvic part and vulva part. Okay. Now what happens next? Once the vesicoureteral canal is formed, what happens next? The mesonephric ducts which are opening in the urogenital sinus, the part of this duct caudal to, you know, the ureteric butt arises from mesonephric, right? So the part which is caudal to the opening of ureteric butt till the urogenital sinus get absorbed, and this gets absorbed into this vesicoureteral canal. So what will happen? First, only the two mesonephric duct opens into this vesicoureteral canal. Now, because of absorption of that part till the ureteric butt, the four openings are there in the vesicoureteral canal, right? The mesonephric duct also open, and now the ureteric butt also opens separately. So the four openings you will see in the vesicoureteral canal. These openings are first close together. They are nearer to each other. What happens next? This ureteric butt. Yes. Sanskar, you want to say something? So, next thing is the ureteric bud moves cranially and laterally. Okay, so this figure will explain everything. This is the mesonephric duct. Okay, so first there are two mesonephric duct open into this cloaca or urogenital sinus, right? Later on, this part, the caudal to this ureteric butt till it's opening into the urogenital sinus gets absorbed. This part is absorbed. So what will happen? Now the four separate openings you will see in this urogenital sinus or vesicoureteral canal. Okay, the upper part, the vesicoureteral canal. Now what happened next, these two ureteric butt openings, they extend cranially and laterally. These two openings extend cranially and laterally, and the triangular shape appears. And this triangular shape is forming the trigone of bladder, right? So after the absorption of this mesonephric duct, four separate openings are there, and out of this, the ureteric bud opening later on moves cranially and laterally. So why it shifted cranially and laterally? There are two reasons. One is continued absorption of this ureteric bud. Then later on, the ureteric bud also starts absorbing. So the opening shifted laterally and cranially. Why cranially? Because of the traction exerted by kidney as they ascend. So kidney ascends upwards, so it will give traction on the opening of ureteric bud. Right, and at the same time, the ureteric bud are also get absorbed into vesicoureteral canal. So, because of this reason, the opening of ureteric bud, they shifted cranially and laterally. Okay, cranially and laterally. So, this is about the openings of four ducts, the two mesonephric duct and two ureteric bud, and how they shifted. This ureteric bud opening shifted cranially and laterally, and trigone is formed. Okay, so you can understand whole of the urinary bladder, it develops separately, while the development of trigone is separate. Okay, it is separately developed. So this triangular area, which is a trigone, it is formed. Where it is formed? It is at the dorsal wall of vesicoureteral canal. It is between the four openings, the upper two openings of erectric bud and lower two openings of mesenteric duct. Okay, so this triangular area is created. Reason I already told you, because of the absorption of mesenteric duct in the dorsal wall of vesicle urethral canal, right? Because of this, the trigone or triangular area is formed. Now, these ureters, when you see the opening, so because of absorption, this ureter opens in the wall obliquely. Obliquely opens at the through the base of the bladder. Then later, these mesonephric ducts, which are actually opening in the vesicles of the canal, shifted caudally. They are still close together and they shifted caudally. Where they shifted caudally? To the lower narrow part of the vesicoureteral canal, which ultimately forms the primitive urethra, right? So this mesonephric duct shifted caudally and entered the prostatic part of urethra, which is derived from the lower narrow part of the vesicoureteral canal, which is primitive urethra. Okay, so what opens in prostatic part of urethra? You know, it is ejaculatory duct. So this terminal part of mesonephric duct, okay, which opens into this prostatic urethra, contributes ejaculatory duct. I hope you understand. Okay, so we were there in the mesonephric duct. So the terminal part of mesonephric duct, okay, it opens into the caudal part of vesicoureteral canal. It contributes primitive urethra, which in future forms a prostatic urethra. And this terminal part, which opens into prostatic urethra, it contributes ejaculatory duct, right? In the female, what happens in female, the distal end of this mesonephric duct degenerates. So as such, there is no ejaculatory duct, so it gets degenerated. Okay? The same thing here, the urogenital sinus, its opening forms this vesicoureteral canal. Expanded part contributes the urinary bladder and narrow part contributes the primitive urethra, and these openings get separated out with each other and forms the trigone. Okay, so let's summarize what are the different sources. Yes, what happens, Soumya? Some problem? I can't hear. So, the different sources of urinary bladder development. The lining epithelium of bladder, you know, it is lined by the transitional epithelium. So, except the trigone, whole of the bladder lining epithelium is derived from the cranial dilated part of vesicoureteral canal, right? So, vesicoureteral canal, it is derived from, yes, it is from cloaca. Cloaca is a part of hindgut, so it is, of course, endodermal in origin. While the lining of epithelium, lining epithelium of trigone, how it is formed? By the absorption of mesonephric duct, derived from intermediate mesoderm, so it is mesodermal in origin, right? But afterwards, first, this is mesodermal in origin, but later, this surrounding endodermal cells overlap, cover the trigone. So later, the whole of the urinary bladder gets lined by endodermal cells. Okay. So first, the trigone is mesodermal in origin. Later, it is overgrown by the surrounding endodermal cells. So finally, whole of the bladder is lined by endodermal epithelium. Right. So this is about epithelium. Now, what about the muscles and the connective tissue? So, muscles and connective tissue coat, which is a second coat, it is of course mesodermal in origin. It is derived from the splanchnopleuric mesoderm surrounding vesicoureteral canal. Okay, so muscles and connective tissue coat, which is mesodermal in origin, derived from splanchnopleuric mesoderm surrounding the vesicoureteral canal. The dorsal part of proximal part of urethra, it is mesodermal. How you explain this? So as I said, the mesodermal opening, duct opening, they shifted caudally, okay, in the primitive urethra, right? So it has remained on the dorsal wall. So the primitive urethra or the proximal part of urethral dorsal wall is mesodermal origin. Remaining whole of the urethra is endodermal, right? Because it is derived from definitive urogenital signs. Urachus. Urachus, it is derived from allantois. Allantois is present at the apical part of the psychourethral canal. So it later on gets atrophied and form the urachus and ultimately form the cord-like fibrous tissue, which is connecting between the umbilicus to the apex of urinary bladder, and it contributes median umbilical ligament. Okay, so allantois form the urachus and its remnant is median umbilical ligament in the adults. So median umbilical ligament is remnant of urachus. So this table is showing the all the parts and the sources which we have discussed. The lining epithelium of the bladder except trigone is endodermal. Why? Because it is derived from the psychourethral canal. Lining epithelium of trigone is mesodermal. Why? Because it is derived from adsorbed part of mesonephric duct. Connective tissue and the smooth muscles, they are derived mesodermal. That is from splanchnopleurate, intraembryonic mesoderm surrounding the psychourethral canal. And urachus and median umbilical ligament is derived from allantois. Okay, so this is about development of urinary bladder. Now, when it develops in fetal life, it is in the abdominal cavity. It is not the pelvic organ. So in infants and the children's, it is present in abdomen, even if it is empty. Up to 6 years of age, it is present in greater pelvis. Still, it is not the pelvic organ. It does not enter the lesser pelvis. Near puberty, it enters the lesser pelvis and then become a pelvic organ. So first it is abdominal, then it is in greater pelvis, and lastly it reaches the lesser pelvis at the time of puberty. Okay, so positional changes according to age. Now the ureter development, we have already discussed. The ureter is derived from uretric bud from the distal part of this regal pelvis till the opening into the vesical urethral canal. That whole part gives rise to ureter. Now the last section of this lecture is the congenital anomalies of urinary bladder. Okay, so first, as I said, always go for urogenesis or absent urinary bladder, duplication, septa formation, which is give rise to our glass bladder. Then the important anomaly, that is the ectopia vesicae or extrophy of the bladder, extrophy of cloaca. Then urachal anomaly, the urachus is there and they give rise to different congenital anomalies like fistula, cyst and sinus, diverticula and megacystis. So agenesis, you can see here the right sided renal agenesis is there, and also here the absent urinary bladder. So urinary bladder is absent along with the right renal agenesis, right? Duplication, because of some septa formation inside this bladder, it is divided into two parts. So this is duplication, okay? And this is a vertical septa, it gives rise to right and left two parts, two bladders, and here the horizontal septa is there. If the horizontal septa is present, it divides this bladder into upper and lower two compartments. And this type of bladder, which appear like hourglass, so it is called as hourglass bladder. Okay, so this is hourglass bladder because of the constriction in between horizontally. This divides this into upper compartment and lower compartment. Okay, so this is the dye injected, and you can see here the hourglass bladder. The next condition is ectopia vesicae or extrophy of bladder. The lower median part of anterior abdominal wall and ventral wall of bladder are absent. So here the bladder is directly exposed to the exterior. Why? Because the lower anterior abdominal wall and the anterior wall of the bladder both could not develop. They are absent. Only, so what is there in front of bladder is only the ectoderm part, thin ectoderm of the anterior abdominal wall and thin endoderm part of the ventral wall of the bladder, which is very unsupported and thin and later on gets ruptured. And because they ruptured, the posterior wall of urinary bladder directly exposed to the exterior, to the surface. And you can see very clearly the posterior wall with the trigone with the three openings. And here the intermittent dribbling of urine is seen from the ureteric orifice to the surface. This condition is usually accompanied by episphalias. What is episphalias? The urethral opening is on the ventral surface of penis. So this is forming the one of the anomaly, episphalias. So here you can see here, the anterior abdominal wall and the ventral wall of urinary bladder is absent. You can see directly the posterior wall of the bladder exposed to the surface. You can see the two, this ureteric opening and here the urethral opening. So trigone of bladder is also seen and continuous dribbling is there. And this is episphalias. The urethral opening is towards the ventral surface of the penis. So what is the cause? Cause is failure of mesoderm to migrate into lower abdominal wall between umbilicus and genital tubercle. So it is a lower anterior abdominal wall development defect, and it is it happens during the lateral folding of embryo. And this mesoderm is migrated from the primitive string, right? So this migration is defective. So the lower anterior abdominal wall will not able to develop and it gave rise to ectopia vasae. Incidence is the 1 in 10,000 birth. Ectrophy of cloaca, it is more severe. Ventral body wall defect causes the greater what are the causes? So it is this here, the cause is more severe. The defect is more severe. So defect in progression and closure of the lateral body wall folds. So complete lateral body wall folds, progression and closure gets defective. So defect is much larger than ectrophy of bladder. There is associated the altered development of ureteric septum leads to anal canal malformation and imperforated anus. So along with the anti-abdominal wall defect, there is anal canal defect with the imperforated anus, and also there is defect in development of external genital. Genital swellings are widely spaced. The incidence is 1 in 30,000. Okay, so this is the ectrophy of cloaca. You can see a big, huge defect is there along with the this bladder posterior surface exposed. The genital defect is there and along with imperforated anus is there. The next anomaly is congenital anomalies of urethra. So as I said, it gave rise to median umbilical ligament in the form of fibrous cord. It may give rise to anomalies like urinary urethral sinus, urethral fistula, and urethral cyst. Though what is the sinus? You know, sinus is the only one side is blind and other side is open. So this other end, that is towards the umbilicus, the sinus, it is persist in the uppermost part of the urethrus and the opening is towards the umbilicus. So it opens at the umbilicus and the upper part is patent and the lower part is fibrous. So it is forming urethral sinus. Fistula, you know, the two-sided opening. So if the lumen is persist throughout the length, at one end it is extending towards opens into the apex of bladder and the other end it opens at the umbilicus. So this is continuous leakage of urinary is there, urine is there from the urethral fistula from umbilicus, and this kind of umbilicus is called as weeping umbilicus. Okay, weeping umbilicus. So this is the sinus. So it is open towards umbilicus and only upper part is patent. Remaining part is fibrous. This is fistula. The throughout the length it is patent. At one end it is open to, at the bladder, and other end it is open at the umbilicus. And there is continuous leakage of urine and it is forming weeping amygdalas. The third condition is urachal cyst, the where the upper part and the lower part is fibrous. In between somewhere there is a cyst formation, and it is because of the secretory activity of this small patent area the cyst is formed. It is called as urachal cyst. The three conditions: urachal sinus, urachal fistula, and urachal cyst. Okay. Now the congenital rectovesical fistula. Sometimes the urorectal septum is supposed to go till the lower part, that is the cloacal membrane. It fails, so it is not developed in the lower part. So this rectum is directly connected with the bladder. Okay, so this is called as congenital rectovesical fistula. So reason is incomplete development of urorectal septum. So this is condition, that is congenital rectovesical fistula. The same way in case of female, the connection is between the vagina and urinary bladder, and it is called as congenital vesico-vaginal fistula. Okay, and this is reason is due to opening of malarial eminence into vesico-urethral canal. That we see with the development of vagina. What is the malarial eminence and how it develops to vagina? The next condition is congenital diverticula, where abnormal dilatations are there in the wall of the bladder, which is usually near the junction of trigone and the remaining part of the bladder. And this, the drawback is that the urine will be collected here. The residual urine will be there, it will not empty, may lead to chronic infection. Now the congenital megacystis, which is also called as megalocystis, it is a rare condition where the bladder is abnormally dilated. You can see here the in the USG, this is dilated and it is enlarged up to the thoracic area. And this is pathologically large urinary bladder. The cause is the congenital disorder of urinary bud. It is also associated with, you can see this is dilated ureter, the dilated ureter, and it is called as hydroureter and dilated pelvis. The reason why it is so much huge dilated, the reason can be the posterior urethral wall. The appearance of posterior urethral wall can cause the abnormally dilated bladder. And these infants are usually suffered from renal failure. Okay. The next condition is Prune Belly syndrome. It is a triad of anomalies. The three anomalies are collectively seen. The wrinkling of abdominal skin due to the underdeveloped abdominal muscles. Okay, the abdominal muscles are not properly developed. Second is the cryptorchidism, that is basically undescended testes. Testes remain in abdomen and does not descend to the normal position, that is in scrotum. That is condition is called as cryptorchidism. The urinary tract malformation is associated with these two conditions is the megalourethral hydronephrosis or reflux, the psychourethral reflux. So these three combinedly called as Prune Belly syndrome. Okay. Now the last part is the ureter. So we have seen the development of ureters, a few anomalies of the ureter like double renal pelvis. So here the ureter is developed normally, but at its terminal end they get divided into two and form the two renal pelvis. The upper renal pelvis usually drains the upper group of calyces, while the lower renal pelvis drains the middle and lower calyces. What is the cause? The premature division of ureteric bud near its termination. The same way this division extend downwards in the ureter, it is forming bifid ureter. So in the upper part, the two ureters are present along with the, of course, two pelvis. But in lower part, they unite to form a single ureter, opens at the normal position. Okay, you can see here, the first ureteral anomaly is the double renal pelvis, where at the terminal end, it divides into two, upper and lower renal pelvis. Then it is a bifid ureter, where the two renal pelvis and two ureters are there. It joins to form a single ureter, opens at the normal place, that is at the superolateral angle of The next condition is double ureter. Double ureter is the throughout the length two renal pelvis and two ureters are there. Okay, and what happens here? The upper ureter is usually opens at ectopic position, while lower ureter is at the normal position. Okay, so this is called as double ureter. So duplication of ureter throughout the length, and the reason is the division of ureteric blood from its origin. Practically, when you see the two ureteric blood arise from the mesenteric duct, will give rise to the two renal pelvis and two ureter. The lower ureter opens at the normal site, while the upper ureter opens at ectopic site. And when it opens the ectopic site, much caudally, either in the bladder, rectum, vagina, it may cross this second ureter and may cause obstruction. So you can see here the double ureter, here the bifid ureter, and here the one more condition is there where the upper end remains blind. So it is a blind ureter. Okay, it will not divide at all. So blind ureter. So ectopic ureter is the abnormal position of opening of ureter in the urinary bladder. Okay, so what are these abnormal position in the male? This ectopic sites may be the bladder neck, prostatic urethra, ductus deferens, seminal vesicle, or rectum. So these are the ectopic position where these ectopic ureter opens. In the females, it may open in the bladder neck, urethra, vagina, vestibule, or rectum. And these kind of patients, they are usually complaints with incontinence of urine. The cause is the ectopic ureter occurs when the ureter is not incorporated in the trigone of urinary bladder. Okay, so it is not incorporate in this trigone, so it opens at the ectopic sites. This figure is explaining very nicely the ectopic sites. Green dot represents the normal sites and remaining are ectopic sites like bladder neck, urethra, in the female vagina, rectum, vestibule, while in the male the bladder neck, urethra, seminal vesicle, ureteric bud, here the rectum. Okay, so these are the last slide, which is showing the other anomalies of ureter, like upper end is blind, it is not divided at all, or the hydroureter, which is a dilated ureter because of some obstruction somewhere, or there may be wall or diverticula. Okay, or the last one is, which is very rare, that is right ureter passes behind the inferior vena cava, may leads to constriction, or kinking leads to obstruction of ureter. So this is all about the urinary bladder ureter and its anomalies. If any query, you can ask me. Okay, thank you.